welcome to another nighttime podcast. I am Poseidon H2O, or Conrad, and I'm sitting here with...
You've got Battle Beast here, also known as Gordon.
And I am Dongver, also known as Jace. And we have a special guest this podcast. We have the man himself, the triple dot, since Spacies. Otherwise known as Brian.
Ah, thank you. That was a really, really warming welcome there. Yeah, you got Brian here, and yeah, my channel is Since Spacies, and this is a real honor. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, we're happy to have you.
Super happy.
We're gonna skip the State of the Union. I almost said State of the Channel.
Oh, wow.
Channel. Just because we got a guest, and instead we're going to ask what everyone's been up to this week. We'll start with our honored guest, Brian. What have you been doing lately?
Well, this week seems like it was such a down week considering the week before. I had EB Expo, Electronic Boutique Gaming Expo, and on the same week we had Xbox Fan Fest, which I'll go into a little more later on the chat, but that was a huge week for me.
Yeah, I remember I was... Oh, sorry, Gordo, go ahead.
No, I just... No kidding, that is a huge week, man.
Yeah.
It's impressive you can do all that.
Yeah, the highlight for me in the Fan Fest was the drifting. That was some pretty sick stuff.
Yeah, that was a cool video. I watched the hell out of that one. That punk music you're picking, too, is that like local... is that local Australian stuff usually, or...?
What's that, sorry?
The punk music you put in.
I'm glad you asked that. Yeah, so it's royalty free because they're disbanded. It's a band called Blister, and they come from Brisbane. And when they were still live and active, I was getting really into them. With my brother was the one that put me onto them. And then just when you think, yeah, this is the next big band, they just drifted off and dropped off the planet. It's really unfortunate, and a lot of Australian bands do that, unfortunately.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I know I like all kinds of music, but there is a special place in my heart for punk rock. I don't know why. I just love it.
The highlight for me in that video was the Don't Trust the Fast Food Chains. If you listen back on that channel, on that video, you'll see that there's burping and cows mooing and stuff in the background. It's great.
Man, well, if you say, unfortunately, Australian bands fall off the face of the earth, I can think of one Canadian band that I wish would fall off the face of the earth, and they're from Hannah. Conrad, you know who they are.
Nickelback.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say here. They are Canadian Albertan treasure, you asshole.
We got a defender.
Hannah is the asshole of the prairies, Dongvers. You just simmer down over there.
I'll spit it. Anyways, I got home late yesterday, and since then, even right up to the time of this podcast, I have been honing my Rocket League skills, getting better. Unfortunately, I've been playing on the console more and more because I like to play on the big screen. But the skills are transferable. I played on Steam on the PC just before, and still scoring tons of goals and hoops.
Dongvers, you've been busy the last little while.
Well, I just got... I bought a condo. So me and my girlfriend got all moved into that and just getting settled and all that kind of stuff. So... And for gaming stuff, I've mostly just been playing World of Warcraft. My guild has been cleared all of normal, Emerald Nightmare, and we're on to Heroic. I think we got the first two bosses down of Heroic, so we're doing all right.
Nice. What about your pal Sadie?
Oh yeah, I also got a puppy, so that's fun. She's quarter Newfoundland Retriever, and then the rest is all Great Pyrenees, so she's gonna be a big dog.
Yeah, she's gonna make Blitz look like a tiny... She's gonna make Blitz look like Zoe, and if you guys know my dogs, that's a huge difference.
What about you, Brian? Do you have any dogs or pets?
I've got two cats, Mimi and Fufu.
No way. No.
And the funny thing is with the... Fufu was the first cat we got, and we got this second cat. They're both rescue cats, and we were sitting there for about a day or so wondering what to call the second cat. And one of our neighbors go, well, you've already got Fufu. You've got to have a Mimi. And I went, nah, that's ridiculous. And then my wife comes home after being at work and she goes, we're going to call her Mimi. And I'm like, hang on a minute. Did you talk to our neighbor or something? How did you both come up with the same name? So it ended up being Mimi. We had no choice. You're not a cat person, I hear in the background.
I love cats.
Okay. Just not those names.
he's not into the names. All right. I think we can move on to questions now.
Yeah.
I think that's probably... Oh, I haven't been doing much. I've been making videos and working. That's it. I don't even...
the end.
I don't know why I go last, because I just bring down the whole segment because I didn't do anything. Well, you can't be that much older than me, Brian.
Okay, so my last year of high school, which is year 12, was 91, and straight after that went straight into work, and, well, I think you're going to find out what that first place of employment was.
Yeah, 91, yeah, mine was 2000, so I guess
yeah.
a little older than I thought you were, but not.
Just a few hockey seasons on you.
Yeah.
Wow, and, I was 4 years old.
Dongver's is 12, so...
Yeah, I'm a youngin'.
Dongver's, you were born in 91, weren't you?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Oh, man. Well, there you go. Now, sorry if you feel old after that one, Brian. But
I'm used to it. Old. All right, you get used to it.
Just try standing beside him sometime. You're going to feel short. Doesn't matter how tall you are.
Actually, I'll be honest with you, though. I'm glad I'm at the age that I am, because I got to witness, like, my channel's called Sid Spacey, so I've got to witness gaming from its very, very start. So yeah, I've grown up, gaming's grown up with me. I've seen it mature to what it is today, this multi-billion-dollar industry. But when I was a kid, it was just like you admitted to only a handful of selected people that you were a gamer, because that was a nerdy thing that used to get beat up for if you got to the wrong people to admit. Yeah.
Oh, were you around for that whole the gamer, the game industry collapse? It was in 89, late 80s, something like
it was 82 or 83. 83 was when ET supposedly brought the whole industry down, which is we all know it wasn't ET in particular, but just the way they went about that game was pinnacle. That was like pinnacle of what was going wrong with the industry at the time.
So you remember that very kind of vividly?
I was only 9, so you know, you talk to a 9-year-old about financial economics, they're just going to go, great, where's the games? They're not going to care.
I just wondered, because I often wondered if we're not... Well, I was wondering, I guess maybe it's not the... Now that I know you're only 9, but maybe I can just bring it up anyway. Do you think we're heading for another, maybe a micro or mini crash, just because of all the, you know, the DLC and the pay-to-play and the pay-to-win schemes, and nothing's new and original? And you see, like, Bethesda is now... They're so big that they stick to something safe, and you don't get the wonder and amazement and the quality of games. And I don't know, is there anything today? Is there any parallels, you guys, or, you know, Brian, or anybody that thinks that, are we headed for that, or is it just too big right now with you know, esports and League of Legends and everything just being so massive that you know, it's the largest and fastest growing entertainment media out there?
I think the industry is big enough to support itself at the moment, but there are going to be some casualties over the next few years if people don't adapt to what's happening. And I'm not anytime soon, but I think that I'm looking at Nintendo with, like, I don't know if it's their last chance, but they need to do something to keep up. I think we'll talk more about it, I guess, a little bit in a second with the Switch. If that's going to be enough to save them, because the Wii U, like, they just came off the big mega successful console of the Wii and then went into this downward spiral with the Wii U. No one knew what the hell that console was supposed to be. They launched the trailer for that one, and everyone's coming away with all questions like, what the hell did we just see? Is that an add-on for the Wii? They thought it was supposed to be just a tablet that you buy to play Wii games, and no one knew what the hell it was. Mm-hmm. So
that was a disaster.
It was a mega disaster, and I got it when I was watching it, but I'm a gamer, so that's, I look out for the cues of what the console that they're launching is going to be about. But you know, the average person on the street, you'd ask them, so have you heard of the Wii U? Oh, is that that bowling thing? They just didn't even know what it was. The marketing was just an absolute fail. So moving on, I think the Switch needs to, they need to absolutely bombard advertisement out there to get the message out of what it's about. And they can't rely on social media alone, because the NX has been rumored for almost 2 years now. It's been bouncing around of what it's going to be, etc. And there are still people out there that don't even know what the NX was supposed to be about. Oh, Nintendo's doing a new console? I didn't hear. So, you know, yeah. they got to really push.
They gotta do actual commercials on actual yeah. TV, because that's well, where the I would say that's where the older crowd comes from. And honestly, yeah. I think Nintendo. That's kind of, it's not necessarily the older crowd they're going for, but those people are buying it for their kids.
Right. Well, they still watch TV. It's funny you watch that last Switch trailer. There was no kids in that video. None.
No, I noticed that actually.
And there was also no one over 35, which I'm a bit right about. <It's>, they killed them all off.
I've seen two trailers for the Switch, and the one thing that I kind of thought was I don't know what I didn't think it was their best decision to show, you know, what the Switch was going to be used for. But they showed, oh, here you can take it on the airplane, you can play Skyrim on the go.
I can't. I don't care though. I can't wait for that experience.
That Skyrim remastered.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't.
Yeah, it's a remaster. And it'll
tell that from the screenshots.
Well, no, Bethesda hasn't actually gone out and said and confirmed, yes, we're releasing it. But why would you put that in the trailer if they're not going to release it? It's just totally ridiculous. Maybe it might be on almost the same level as the Xbox One. Again, we're just speculating. But that's what I've heard on some channels out there, saying that this console could be, if not as powerful as Xbox One, but maybe slightly more powerful. Could you imagine a handheld with Xbox One capability? That's insane. That's pretty cool,
I
think.
Let's say PS4 ability. I hate my Xbox One.
I'm about to get my first Xbox my first PlayStation 4 in about 2 weeks from now, so can't wait for that.
Yeah, nice. Let me know, because I've been on the razor's edge of converting after being with Xbox since the original this
brick.
The Xbox One is so bad for me.
Yeah, I mean, it plays games, it's fine, but you use it for all.
Yeah, sorry. The games. Wow, Rocket League froze twice on me today. But
oh, really?
Oh, wow.
But in general, the games are okay. But anything else, which they, then you know, oh, it's a gaming console. No, they advertise it as the end all, be all of your home entertainment system. Every app I try to use with it is awful. The whole thing needs to be restarted constantly because your apps semi freeze. Internet. The YouTube,
well,
Netflix,
I think,
they all semi-freeze.
I think Phil Spencer, by the way, who I met, he has done quite a good job of getting away from, I don't know what the first head of Xbox name was before him, but that was a train wreck of a reveal. No, it wasn't Bill Gates, but it was an absolute train wreck.
Didn't do one reveal? It was Bill Gates and The Rock. Anyways, off topic, sorry.
Oh, that's the original Xbox. Yeah, that's cringeworthy. But, the Xbox has pulled away from that whole, oh, and you can watch TV in your lounge room and play games. Like, they've moved away from that a lot. They've removed the Kinect. Some people cheer that decision. I'm one of the few that like the Kinect and use it for what it's meant for. Like, I love walking into my house and saying Xbox on, and the whole thing just lights up and comes on, not having to fumble around for remotes. That's just how much do they go for? About $150? It's a $150 universal remote.
That's where you and me are different.
It wasn't the Kinect that people didn't want. It was the privacy, where the Xbox One had the ability to turn on the Kinect to the camera and record without ever you knowing or you turning it on. That's what people said. Hey, get rid of that. Keep the Kinect.
Yeah.
And they just said, no, we're getting rid of it.
They were selling blank covers for it, weren't they? Like people can go out and buy that plastic bit to go over the top of the camera.
Well, I just put a post-it note on the old.
Well, you could do that. Oh, and it just a little. Did you know I was actually part of the pilot program for the original Kinect? I got a Kinect for free. Yeah, so I received my Kinect when it was still called Project Natal. On that towel, whatever that was.
No way.
Yeah. And I wasn't allowed to go on social media about it. I had no way of being able to tell anyone about it, but there was nothing against people coming over to my house and playing it. So I get my mate to come over and I said, yeah, you can play it, no problems, but just don't put any pictures or anything like that about it. So he plays, what's that, Kinect Sports, and we're doing the bowling. And he goes, oh, I wonder if you can bowl over him, you know, like cricket style. He smashes my light. The light just goes flying. but it turns out you could bowl over him in bowling.
Well, speaking of Xbox, you were at the Xbox Fan Fest, or whatever.
Yeah, that's right.
Some videos and stuff. Yeah, how did that go?
Man, that was awesome. It was like. But for me, it wasn't the handouts were nice. I mean, I'm looking at my limited edition Xbox One controller now, which I got. It's $110 value. Everyone gets one. Oprah Winfrey style.
Nice.
But for me, it was being able to talk to other gamers, which is why I started my channel to begin with. I wanted a lot of the people at my work, they don't game, they're not into gaming, and you talk to them about game, you're excited about a new game, and they're just looking at you going, well, what's a Nintendo? Like, and it just bring, yeah, exactly. I go into work with all my gaming shirts, they're just looking at me going like, do you have anything that's like, you know, not for kids? So anyway, back to the Xbox Fan Fest, though. That was awesome. We got to, it really highlighted some of the great parts of Sydney, and it was kind of like an opportunity for Phil Spencer to just capture all the great things that this city's got to offer. It was really fantastic going out to the drag racing. Like, I'm a bit of a rev head. I'm not really... I don't know all the engine parts or anything like that, but I appreciate the V8 racing that we've got, the scene that we've got here in Australia, and seeing the drag racing between the two Australian cars that are in the Forza Horizon 3 going up the quarter mile. That was awesome, seeing that. But I don't know if you guys have seen the video, but the drift racing, I highly recommend anyone, if you ever get the chance, to it. Yeah. Yeah. Like, I went home, there was just bits of rubber all over me, and it's just, you couldn't escape it.
Man, and you did it, like, in the car, too. That was so cool.
Yeah, everyone, so...
I was like, man, how did those guys not kill anybody?
There was no accidents all day long. They were doing four cars at every given time. So there's two segregated tracks, so two cars versus each other at the same time. And... they were going for 4 hours non-stop, and they had multiple cars that were, you know, coming in to sort of substitute for each other. And I think I
needed to change tires.
Well, maybe that was it, yeah. So I only saw one barrier get hit, and it was not a concrete barrier, thank God. It was just a plastic barrier. And I saw one car, he was really trying to push it as far as he could go towards the end of the day, and he spun out and faced the other way. That was the only thing that we saw that went wrong. So it was a major success, the way those guys handled it. I'd love to know where their what racing team they were to give them a plug, but maybe later.
What's anything? Oh, what about meeting Phil Spencer there? It was the same one, right?
Yeah, it was so brief, and. I'm hopeless with the camera. I still got to get used to videoing, because I'm old school. I think that if you're pointing a camera towards someone, it's kind of rude, but you kind of need to do that for the channel. So I'm still trying to work out the best
way. Those guys are so used to it, they're PR gentlemen.
Yeah, I should have thought about that at the time, but I was too busy just chatting away, because he pointed me out of the crowd, because I'm wearing my Penguins jacket at the time, my Penguins jersey. And he goes, are you from Pittsburgh? And I went, nah, mate.
Way off. Did you have anything else to say about Xbox Fan Fest?
Oh no! So yeah, we got to meet a few local celebrities, probably guys that you would never heard of. I had I was wearing a Pac-Man shirt, and this guy that he's in a local TV show, which is extremely rude, extremely funny. And if you ever get the chance to see a show called Howzo's, there's so much in jokes for Australians that we get, you guys would not get, but it's just so rude and funny. But the guy, the one of the main stars from that show, he was hosting the whole Xbox Fan Fest for the Gears of War launch. And he's come up to me with the cameras and the lights and everything. He's going, "Oh my God, check out this guy. He must have been gaming from like way back. Had checked him out." And I'm like, yeah, thanks, man. And by this time of the night, I've already had so many, because I was just handing out champagne all night and I'm plastered. And but he asked me, "So how long have you been playing for?" Like on the camera, and I've gone, "Since Spacies." So I got my plug for the channel in.
I guess we can move on to the next question. I think it's Brian.
Yes. So this is for all. What is the most expensive console that you've ever bought?
I think I could actually probably go first on this one because you might all hate me. I don't pay as much as most people for consoles. Like, I see something come out and I don't buy it right away ever, because I know in 6 to 8 months price is gonna drop. And or the most I ever spent, it was two different consoles. I spent $199 on my PS2, and I spent $199 replacing my Xbox 360 with the Xbox 360 Elite. That was it. I had a PS3 that I got. My sister gave me hers because it wasn't working.
Is that Canadian? Canadian, not American dollars, right?
Canadian dollars. Okay. So about $12 American. I mean, now it is, it seems like. But anyway, my sister gave me her PS3. And I went on Facebook and said, "Hey, does anybody have a PS3 that doesn't work?
I'm going to try that."
Back to me in 20 minutes. And his had the yellow light of death. And my sister's needed a new hard drive. So I just splashed the hard drive in. Free PS3. It was pretty awesome.
Wow.
And I got my $5 Sega Genesis. Still works like a charm. I was like, I don't go all out for anything like that. That's why I don't have an Xbox One yet, because the price isn't where I like it yet. Or a PS4. Either one of them. I'll just wait. Maybe I'll get one used at some point. Whatever works. Actually, you know what? I keep trying to win that freaking Philip DeFranco. He's always giving them away on his channel. Never picked us yet. But maybe one day.
You might have a better chance at Lotto. I just
looked it up. The Australian and Canadian dollar. One Canadian dollar is worth 99 cents Australian.
Yeah, it's almost, it's par for par. Yeah, it's pretty much. I mean, we feel. In other words, we feel your pain.
Yeah, worse too, because it's. Yeah. It was just. I just had a little. I was gonna say argument, but it wasn't an argument. We were just discussing it in the comments of a video on YouTube, and I guess it's. Is it like $100 to buy a newer game and in Australia?
It'd be about that much. Yep. Yep. And or $120 in some cases.
Ooh, no, wow. No, it's not 80. It's 80 plus 15 for your first DLC plus 49.99.
Yeah. Mine would.
You go ahead. No, Jace, I insist you go.
Okay, I probably Xbox One. I think I bought like the week release of the when it came out there, and I think it was like $500 or something like that. I can't remember exactly, but
yowza.
Yeah, it was big, but it was like the Kinect one and all that shit. So then I get it home and I go to plug in my Kinect and Kinect doesn't work. So then I had to wait like, I think like 4 months before I could get a new Kinect because they were so backed up or whatever. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that was my most expensive one.
Okay. For me, price tag wise was the Xbox One for sure, just because I bought a Gen 1, like not like maybe 2 months after release. But the most money into a console I've sunk has definitely been the Xbox 360, just because I bought three of them, not because I wanted to play them all by myself, but Xbox 360 had an atrocious defect rate of 35% plus. And my first two crapped out. I bought a third one. It crapped out. I was able to fix one with the parts from the first and the second one. And then I bought the, what did you call it, Legacy Edition one, the black one. So I guess Elite. I bought four. Yeah, the Elite. I bought four of those, but I guess one of those doesn't count because I fixed using parts from the first and second one. So, but to be fair, I could justify it. Some people skydive. Some people go on vacation. I was having so much fun on the 360. I was angry about it, the Red Ring of Death, but I was having ridiculous amounts of fun. I could justify the money I sunk into it. The Xbox One, I could, you know, throw it out the window tomorrow and not miss it. So I'm that price tag. Is like, I would never buy another one if it didn't go. I'd go PS4, but I think I'd wait for the Switch now.
Xbox One, $599.
Oh yeah,
$100 more than I paid.
And but if you go back to 92 or 93, the Mega CD came out here in Australia. I got it for $450. After that was after discount. The Mega CD retailed for, which was your Sega CD, it retailed for $699 Australian at the time.
Oh wow!
Mega CD. So.
What's here?
Oh, that was fighting words. Oh yeah, that's, man, and some stuff I remember hearing, like way back when the first Ataris and stuff were coming out, some of those things were just outrageous. Like in the States they were selling for like 700 American.
Oh wow.
That's, but I mean, those things back then, they were cutting edge. Who knew how far we'd come, right?
Hey, I still would prefer to play combat over most of the stuff that's coming out now.
I gotta tell you, I play a lot of old games.
I was, don't lie, you guys are psyched for Call of Duty 70.
Yeah, right.
You're Call of Duty went downhill. Buy it, don't
yeah, that's true.
Alright, moving on. We have a fan question from @WeirdAndRetro on Twitter. He asks, what is your most memorable or favorite experience working at the hotline? This one's for Brian, obviously. And I would also add to that, what would also be your favorite things about working at the magazines and at the game store?
Yeah, so I think before I answer that, I'll just let everyone know that not only, and I got to tell you, I find it very hard to keep pronouncing it as Sega, because here in Australia, it's pronounced Sega, and that's how we always answered it. And the amount of flack I get online for that is just, anyway, moving right along.
Every time you have a Sega game, it goes Sega.
Well, maybe in Australia it goes, I will, I will do a video on why we pronounce it as Sega, but that's another story for another time. What I was also going to say is that I also wrote for Hyper Magazine, which is a Australian and New Zealand video game magazine, which is still up and running today, which I find amazing that they can still be in business when magazines are a dying format. And before that, I was working on Megazone magazine, which was actually owned by the distributors of Sega here in Australia. So it was always something that I wanted to do when I left high school, was to write for a magazine, because I actually had my own magazine, which was a fanzine called the Sega Times. And that's how I got the job, was sending in copies of my magazine into Sega, and they eventually caved in and said, we've got to get this guy a job here. So that's how I got a job. Pester Microsoft kids. Exactly. Kids at home. Kids at home, keep pestering Sony and Xbox and Nintendo with your stuff. They will eventually cave in.
See, I told you guys, browsers will eventually accept me. Like, it's just a matter of time.
You just keep sending me dick pics, bombers.
So the most memorable things to working at Sega was seeing and playing Sonic before it came out. That was I was this was actually before I worked there. I got invited to come in and have a look at this new thing that's going to be bigger than Mario, they were saying. And I'm like, bigger than Mario? All right. We'll see how this works out. And they put me down in front of this Sega Mega Drive, and they had this circuit board sticking out of the where the cartridge goes in. I thought, wow, this is what they do here. And they had the ROM chips placed into the circuit board for a beta version of, they weren't called betas back then, they were just EEPROMs. And it had Sonic running down a hill, outrunning an apple rolling down the hill. Now, if there's any big Sega heads here, you'd know that that's actually from Castle of Illusion, Mickey Mouse. So they actually borrowed it. They took it out of Sonic eventually and put it into Mickey Mouse instead. So that, for me, I'll never be able to forget that. That's something special. Also, getting to dress up as Sonic at roadshow events.
Picture it didn't happen.
What's that, sorry?
Pictures or it didn't happen. How many pictures have you dressed up as Sonic?
I've only got one photo, because you got to remember, this is before everyone had a mobile, and I've only got a handful of photos that we didn't document anything from the day, which is my biggest regret. There is one video that I've got, though, from inside the hotline, and when I reach 100 subscribers, I am going to be posting that video on my channel. But I have got one photo of Sonic going up an escalator. That was pretty funny.
That's awesome. Sonic was like my favorite game when I was a kid. Like, I remember coming down Christmas morning and my parents got me Sonic 3D for the Genesis, and I lost my shit.
So
I was actually playing some Sonic 2.
Hello, we lost you.
Oh,
okay, he's back again. Okay.
Yeah, sorry about that. I had my mic muted because I have a train going. But yeah, I was playing Sonic 2 on the weekend. Please tell me that the chemical zone was not your idea.
Oh God.
If it was, we can't be friends anymore.
It's not my... No, I had nothing to do with the... I'll tell you what, though. With Sonic 2, I'm actually staring at my Mega Drive and Mega CD now, and I've got Sonic and Knuckles in there with Sonic 2 up on top of it. And
I love the Sonic and Knuckles cartridge. It's so cool.
Isn't it unique? It's like DLC before DLC ever was a thing. And my copy of Sonic 2 is rather unique. It was actually given out to all Sega staff members before they had finalized the artwork for the cover. So mine has just got, and it's, I wish I had looked after it a little more. It's just got Sonic the Hedgehog 2 written on it in a sticker that's blue and white. That's it. There's no artwork or anything for it. So
that's really cool.
At least I've got something like that from it. I don't have much stuff or memorabilia from the Sega days. I wish I had held on to more.
I am so jealous of that Sonic cart you're talking about right now.
I've
just really started collecting in like the last couple of years or so, and I don't have a lot of extra income, so I don't go out and buy a whole bunch of stuff. But the stuff I try to find is stuff like that. And like, you know, maybe you find it in. I had a copy of actually Dragon Warrior 7, which I guess was the biggest selling game ever in Japan, but here it's super rare. I bought a PS2 with a whole bunch of games, and it was in there. And that's how I find most of my collection, but. Man, that Sega card, I'm so jealous. That's awesome, man.
Oh, well, I just wish I had more. That's, but I'm glad I've at least got that.
Yeah, that's awesome. Like, that's the centerpiece. That'd be the centerpiece to any collection, in my opinion. I love Sega. I never had any friends. I had a friend for, like, I don't know, 2 weeks before he moved. He got a Super Nintendo. And then he moved out of the town, so I didn't really get too much Super Nintendo back in the day, but I still, don't get me wrong, I love Super Nintendo, but I just Sega Genesis is where it's at for me.
Oh, I just wasn't a Nintendo fan back in the day. I wasn't, like, it looked cool and I thought, yeah, this is really great, but when I went to the arcades and you would see Space Harrier and Outrun and Afterburner and these type of games in the cabinets, they were crazy. You'd get in them. It wasn't just a game, it was an experience, it was a ride. And then when I found out that they actually developed home consoles, I was thinking, well, that's cool. I feel if I can get that arcade experience somehow in my house, that'd be awesome. Of course, the gaming industry has changed. When the Mega Drive was first being marketed, it was marketed as an arcade machine for the home, but they quickly realized that arcade experiences only are meant to be that to keep getting people pumping in quarters or 20-cent coins as it is here. And that's not going to be enough to keep people coming back and buying more games. They had to make the more longer, bigger, fully fleshed out experiences like Sonic the Hedgehog, which that's what that game was designed to address, that problem.
Thank God they did, because we never got Phantasy Star or Shining Force, so they didn't figure that out.
I tweeted a picture of Phantasy Star 2 because someone asked, name a great game from 1989, and I just instantly thought of Phantasy Star 2. I tweeted a picture of the end boss. I've got like 50 likes for that so far, just in 24 hours.
I didn't even see that. I must have missed that one. I'll look for it, though.
Hey, Brian, I've got something for you here.
Yeah, sure.
When you worked at the magazine, what kind of work was required? You know, daily duties, kind of writing, anything else?
Yeah, so we would just clock in and we'd be on the phones most of the time. And the computer screens that we had back then were green monochrome screens. They were not, like, you didn't have any screenshots to refer off or anything like that. We had printed out paperwork that we got from Sega of America. Sega of America. We would also write our own maps. I've still got some of those maps. Some of them were sent in from fans out there, which was my first clue that gamers were full on. And before working at Sega, I didn't realize that there were other people out there that really just lived and breathed video gaming like I was doing at the time. And there's one that I've got up there. This guy had played Phantasy Star, the original Master System version. He had fully fleshed out color maps. He sent them in. I would love to track that guy down now, what is it, 25 years or so later, and try and see if I can get this posted and say, hey man, thanks for sending that in. Because we wrote back to him, but we never got a response back to see if he got that or not. It's just insane.
He probably went on to start Brady Games and did all those magazines.
That's the thing, who knows? Yeah, yeah. So not only did we have to take calls from all over Australia, we would also get asked for reviewing games for marketing purposes. So we would get a game in and say, yeah, I think this is going to do really well, or this just plain sucks, whatever was the case. And we'd get those games, not on cartridge, obviously, because they were not fully developed at that stage. They would send them in tubes of chips, of computer chips that you'd have to put into an EEPROM board to put into the cartridge slot. And someone found out later, because I still keep in touch with the other Sega Hotline staff members, or Sega Masters as we called ourselves, we found out that those chips, which contained, you know, not fully finished games and half completed games, or some games that just never got released, could you imagine having access to that now? Well, someone threw them out. My head, my heart just caved in when I heard this. And I've just gone, are you kidding me? I would have stolen them if I had have known that it was going to happen. I'd rather get in trouble. I would rather be done for theft than see that, because that, to me, was a bigger crime. That was a bigger, far bigger crime than me stealing them. So, I would.
That kind of thing happens all the time when people.
Yeah.
The value of what it is. Have, or it hasn't become valuable yet. So
Well, like the Doctor Who early seasons.
Yeah, BBC, they got just, like, the BBC had a scrapping policy. Yeah,
they did that here in Australia. There was a music show called Countdown in the 70s and 80s, and they used to get the big acts at the time that other countries were just jealous that we managed to get and they couldn't. And we had AC/DC recording sessions filmed over because they wanted to recycle the tapes.
Oh. Dongvers, you do not tell your dad about that.
Yeah.
He will go.
So, but yeah, that's my favorite memories of working at the hotline. I've got heaps more, but as the years roll on, it's getting harder and harder to remember them. We don't have the photos or the videos or the, you know, the stuff that the kids have got access to now. Jeez, I sound old. But, you know, I just wish we had recorded more. That's my biggest regret of when working on the hotline. And also working in the game shop, the Gamesman, which I will try and do a plug for, a video for later. They have a shop which is just local around here, and they have a retro section of the game store, which is on par with some of the stuff I've seen in Japan. It's just absolutely unreal that the stuff that they've got in there. They've got all the gaming watches, all the Intellivision, ColecoVision stuff, the Atari.
ColecoVision and a ColecoVision back in the day. I mean, my dad owned the Intellivision. There's like the little keyboard one you plugged into the TV.
Yeah, yeah.
I played Spider Side all the time. That was crazy. And then me and my buddy, the same one who actually got the Super Nintendo and then moved right away, we bought a ColecoVision at a garage sale for $20 and we were like in grade four. It was awesome. His mom wouldn't let us play the Dungeons and Dragons game because she was religious and she thought it was evil, but we just waited until she went to bed and played it anyway.
Witchcraft.
I never thought that would actually be a real thing, but I wow, that's insane.
Yeah, well, sometimes I don't want to get into it because people will get mad.
Yeah, moving right along.
Jay, so why don't you go ahead with your next one?
Sure. So which game did you get the most questions about on the hotline, Brian?
Easily, without a doubt, Alex Kidd in Miracle World. It was the built-in game for the Sega Master System. So just to put you in the picture a little bit, here in Australia, Sega actually was heavily marketed in this country and actually won the console battle in this country. They were more popular. You might get a few people comment below saying, oh, wait, Nintendo was bigger, but sales-wise, Sega was far bigger up until the Sega Saturn came out, and then they started losing the battle then.
Yeah.
Started losing that battle worldwide. 32X and all the rest of the add-ons, just people had put their hands up in the air and said, enough's enough. But no, that was the built-in game to the Sega Master System 1 and 2. Well, most of Sega Master System 1's had it. And I was lucky enough to have actually played that game on cartridge, which is rare as hen's teeth now. I'd love to get my hands on that now. And that was enough to get me hired as well. So one of the first questions they asked me, have you played Alex Kidd in Miracle World? And I said, yeah, we've beaten it a few times. You're in. So, and there were some calls that would drop in. Welcome to Sega Hotline. You're speaking with Brian. Let me guess, you're stuck in a room and there's a ghost that keeps killing you and you don't know what to do. Oh man, you're good.
Well, that's surprising. I thought for sure it would have been one of the RPGs like Phantasy Star or something.
Oh, we had guys dedicated to that, but you got to remember that back in that era, the RPGs didn't get sold nearly as much as they should have. Not like today. Even today, the RPGs don't sell as well as your Call of Duties, for example. We did have guys set aside for Phantasy Star 1 and 2. There was a hint book with 2, so that wasn't needed as much. We had one couple that would call up for Phantasy Star every step of the way. We called them the mother and son team. And they were from Canberra, and the guy was like at least in his 40s, and his mum was older, of course, and they would constantly call in every step of the way. They finally finished it 6 months down the track, and we'd be like, oh, thank God they finished it now. And they're like, oh, thank you so much. You guys have been wonderful, and we're now going to get that new, what's it called, Mega Drive, and I believe they've got the new game for that one. And we're thinking, no, don't, no, no.
Didn't they have to pay, like, every time they called in, wouldn't they have to pay?
Nah, so this was before the whole pay model came in. They were talking that up just as I left. And we had, back then it was 00055, call now, and all this sort of stuff. And you'd have to get your mum's permission before you call. That all just kicked in just as I left. But back then it was a service that you got as a Sega customer. And... oh, wow. Or you had, but you had to be a member of the Sega Club to get cheats. And we'd have kids. You'll see it in the video that if I find it. It's in the garage in the VHS somewhere. But it's they'd always call up trying to trick us into saying, yeah, I'm a member. And you'd, okay, so what's your number? I lost a card. So that was like our daily experience. And I kind of got jaded with having to get them to be a member before giving out stuff. I just wanted to tell them the codes and stuff, because I figured that if they're Sega members, that should all, if they're Sega customers, that should all be enough to get cheats and whatever on that hotline.
It makes sense. And actually, you know what? I heard that Nintendo just finally stopped their customer. Because there's that number on the bottom of your Nintendo. You could call that up until like 2015 and they'd still help you out for free.
I'm sorry. That's insane. That is awesome. That really is awesome.
That's good customer service right there. Okay. I can't believe that. Like, that's awesome. But, I mean... okay, you know what? We'll move on. I didn't realize this was going to take so long.
I'm so sorry. I crap on a bit, don't I?
it's funny because we usually aim for 45 minutes for the podcast. The first one was an hour and 20 minutes.
So. Yeah, we cut it short, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, we did. We cut some stuff out of it. Like, just in the middle, we decided we'll cut this out. You got another couple questions here, Brian. We'll do yours, and then we'll just do what's on the list.
So I've just got here that what's the hardest games you can remember playing, or hardest game I should say, but you loved it so much that you didn't care and you just kept coming back for more, like a real sucker.
I'll go first. I definitely think I had a PS2, and I bought, like, I was so into, like, Final Fantasy style RPGs, like turn-based stuff, but I never had one myself. I remember watching my buddy Duck, is what we called him, and he had he would play Final Fantasy 2, I think. I can't remember, but I was just so enthralled by it. I was just like, oh man, this is so awesome. So I finally saved up enough money. I went and bought a PS2 game. And it was Grandia 2.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, and I played the shit out of that game. And I remember being so mad at that game. Like, I would stop playing for, like, a half an hour. Then I'd be like, well, maybe I'll just try it again. Like, you know, whatever. And but, like, just being enraged. A little Dongver is just mad as hell at the game. And, like, but, yeah, I always did come back to it. And I eventually did beat it, but it was, like, one of the hardest games I've ever played.
Man, I just sent that in to be sold, like, 2 months ago. I wish I would have known that. I would have maybe kept it and given it a whirl.
Yeah.
Well, for me, it was... I think this game came out on the Dreamcast originally, but it was ported to the original Xbox. And it's not necessarily the hardest game, but there are parts of it that are super hard. You have to have, like, just robot reflexes, and that's Shenmue 2.
I knew you were going to say that. I don't know why you're... Yeah. I just had a feeling it was getting down that way. Yeah.
I still love that game. And, like, it never... You know, like, it has so much replay value is what I'm trying to say. And just, like, even playing the, you know, the mini games in the game, like Lucky Hit... You can play that for hours, and then the arm wrestling when you have to—it's just tap X or tap A over and over.
It's ruthless.
The hard levels. Oh man! And then learning—you get—you get to the boss stages where you have to win fights, and you know, and you're in the dragon quarter, and you have to win all the three, and it's basically—I can't remember what other Sega game they took the warriors from. But that game, it just has parts of it. They're so hard, and there's so many, like, not Easter eggs, but hidden parts of it. And I just keep playing through it. And I always go back to it. It's great. I really want Shenmue 3 to come out. I've wanted to ever since I finished Shenmue 2. And
I absolutely worship Shenmue, and I want to visit the township. And one day, I've been to Japan now 6 times. I'm going on my 7th trip. Still haven't been to that Yokohama township that's down in that way. One day I'll do it. But yeah, I just remember my first trip to Japan thinking, oh my god, this is just like Shenmue. Every time that I'd even just stupid little things like the light switches, the housing, the way they've got their walls all set up, it was just the amount of detail that was in that game for that time is just not enough credit.
I never did play Shenmue 1, but I watched a ton of content on YouTube about it, just so I could get the backstory.
I've got a watch from that game, the actual watch that he has, Ryu.
No way.
Yeah, I hunted it down on eBay, and that's one of my, like, most... That's in my display cabinet, along with the gaming watches and all the other stuff that I've got that I highly prize. Yeah.
That's awesome.
What about you, Conrad? What's the hardest game for you?
Well, as anyone who's watched our channel knows, I am not very good at video games.
It takes a big man to admit it.
Man, I want to say Dark Souls, but yeah. I might have given up on Dark Souls because...
Give it time.
God damn it. I can't... There's this, like, night guy, and he's in, like, one of the first levels, and I just can't get past him. I've tried everything. I've had him so close. Yeah, it's... Oh, anyway. But... Honestly, I think it's probably Jurassic Park for Sega Genesis.
Oh.
I couldn't get past the first level as a kid, ever. With the Raptor or with, what's his name there? Alan Grant. And when I started my collection for Genesis, it was the first game I bought. And I still can't get past the third level. But I'm going to get there. I'm going to get it. One of these days, I'm going to get it.
That's a let's play waiting to happen.
Oh, that's a let's fail. I got a couple of those on the channel, eh, Dongvers?
Listen,
I want to get you. You gotta,
it's
you
not
gotta
my
get,
fault.
I'm going to track down that Shinobi, man.
And yeah, that game was fun.
I think with an actual Genesis controller and not the crappy...
Yeah,
we tried
that was
to play
the thing,
on
too.
Xbox.
I'm actually staring at that now. I've got the Revenge of Shinobi, but this is the Mega CD pack-in version that they've got. I've got the box there. I've got to get that on the channel as well.
Man, I remember Booger Man, too. That was one of my favorites. Oh, yeah. That was, like, the best game, Booger Man. Oh.
That was a rare one, too, I think. I don't think many people bought it.
So,
I
did
the Kickstarter one, but it didn't go.
So for me, it'd have to be Super Ghouls and Ghosts on Super Nintendo. That is just, it's just cruel, unforgiving, but gorgeous to look at. The music is fantastic. You just keep wanting to push yourself on. It's like a bad relationship. It's just. You just,
it's so good.
It hurts so good, yeah. So you know that the game is awesome and you should be dedicating everything to it, but it's just unforgiving. You get hit once, you become a duck. You get hit, don't duck, you lose, that's right, sorry, you lose your armor. And that's it, there's no, we'll let you have 5 hits and then you die. Nah, it's just one hit after that, you're dead.
Yeah. Oh, that might be the first game I ever rage quit. I have a long history of rage quitting games.
So we
it was just so hard. I couldn't enjoy it because I was so bad at it that if you're only playing for a minute, you don't get any enjoyment out of it.
Like, yeah.
Especially when you're passing the controller around with 5 or 6 other guys.
Oh, geez, that's one way to end relationships there, friendships. Well, this game sucks.
We see a fair amount of the game. I don't think we ever beat it, but... my one buddy Russ got fairly far in it, like at least one time, and we were all sitting there watching. But we never did get anywhere close to the end, I don't think.
That's a co-op rage quit. Yeah, that's a
good one. Yeah. I forgot about that. That is rough. That'd be a good watch Poseidon cry video for Halloween.
Let's cries.
Let's cries. All right, moving right along. Brian, this one's just for you because we don't live there. Australia, I don't know, for any of our viewers that don't know, some games just get straight up banned for almost no reason. Have you ever missed out on a game because of that?
Not.
And if not, or if so, which ones? And if not, how did you get around it?
I personally haven't gone out of my way to get a game that has been banned. I just figured that there's just so many other games out there on the market, it's just not worth losing sleep over. The only one game that did get touched or did get sort of manipulated that I really hate is the South Park Stick of Truth.
Oh, I've seen that.
And no, it wasn't banned, but they edited some scenes out of it. And I'm thinking, if you are buying a South Park game, you are not expecting it to be about a bunch of kids holding hands and singing Kumbaya. It is a full-on experience, and you shouldn't be editing that stuff out of it, because that's what South Park is about. And
yeah,
I do love how they got around it to a degree. They'd have the audio playing, and they'd have a picture of a koala crying on the tree. Like looking all sad faced. I just thought that was.
You got the better one, because the European version.
Yeah.
It just had like the EU flag or something like that.
Yeah. No, the koala crying for me was, and also if you go to South Park's website to watch videos in Australia, and they're banned, well, they're not banned, but they haven't got the rights to show them here. You'll see a picture of Russell Crowe fighting around the world. Sorry, mate, but this video is not available in your part of the world. Terribly sorry about that.
There's got to be something in Canada that we can't watch from it. And they did have that Mountie character in a few episodes of Terrence and Phillip.
I don't know, man. Canada's pretty liberal when it comes to ratings. Like, even Deadpool was 14. That's it.
No, Deadpool was rated R. It wasn't
in the States, not here.
All right, Brian, you had one final question before we do shout-outs.
Yeah, so with the Nintendo Switch coming out, did anyone here catch that reveal? Would you be buying it next March? I think I've already got a vibe from one or two of you that no, but yeah, I'll put it out there. Who's excited for it, or at least curious?
I'm definitely curious about it, but like I said before, I don't pay full price for consoles, so I definitely won't be buying it in March. But hey, you never know. A little way down the road, if I find a good used one for cheap or something, yeah, I'd probably go for it. Seems kind of neat. I'm not really too much into handhelds. I mean, I have a DS and a PSP, but 90% of the time I just use them to test games to sell. That's about all I use them for.
I mean, if a Pokemon game comes out for it, I probably will, but...
We got a buyer. We got one then. You can bet.
That looks pretty neat, though.
Only if it launches with Pokemon.
It won't launch with it, though. I think that they've got, Sun and Moon out now. They've never made any announcements about any Pokemon game for this new machine. I think if there was a Pokemon coming out for it, they would have at least dropped the hint by now. So,
yeah, I think so, too.
Oh, yeah, they would not let that one just slide by. They would jump on it.
But I think they're going to try and milk their sales from Sun and Moon. I think maybe towards Christmas next year you might see possibly a hint of a Pokemon coming out for the... For, I was going to call it the NX. Sorry, the Switch. Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I kept calling the NX too. Hmm. What about you, Gordon?
Yeah, I'm kind of like you. I wouldn't get the first release Gen 1 kind of thing, because all these consoles and... Or Galaxy Note 7, they have things like, remember when the 360 first came out?
Note 7.
Yeah,
it's gonna explode on you.
Yeah. Well, when the Xbox 360 first came out, the power cord, it has a huge, I don't know, amplifier, converter, whatever it is.
Yeah, that big.
And it would start on fire too. And so, you know, they fixed that in Gen 2, and then Gen 2 was super bad with the disc trays, and then the Elite came out. I probably wouldn't wait till, the Switch Super Switch came out or whatever, but I would Nintendo's wait.
Pretty good though. They've always. I don't remember, and maybe Brian would remember more. I don't remember Nintendo having a problem with consoles yet.
The only thing I can think of with, and this is not any in any way a hindrance on it on the way it performs, but the color from the fire retarded chemicals that they use on the Super Nintendo. Like I'm looking at mine here now. The bottom yellow. The bottom half of it's yellow. The top part looks fine. So. Apart from that, it never gets the sun. It's just general light and apart from that though, I'm looking at just here across from me now, GameCube. It's operating fine. A Super Nintendo next to it, and a Wii U. We'll see what happens with the Wii U as it goes down the track. I've never had a problem, but I've never had a problem with a Nintendo consoles. It's one thing you get to give them kudos for is that their consoles have got good build quality. But we're worried about the, like you said, with the Switch, the constant changing of the controllers, the Joy-Con 1 and the Joy-Con 2 or whatever they call it. Is that going to wear out eventually as you keep swapping them in and out? That's something we've got to keep an eye out. Yeah, there's a lot of clickable moving parts. Kids are going to lose that crap. We know what kids are like. They can't be trusted with stuff like that.
That's part of their marketing. They're like, oh, well, let's just let the kids lose everything for it and let's have to come back and give us more Apple money. Oh, man. I hate those channels. Generally, I hate those channels that wreck technology just for the sake of wrecking it.
Oh, so did you see... go on, sorry.
The dude like took an Apple on one of the new iPhones. He's like, make your own headphone jack, and he just drilled a hole in it and told people it worked. Microwave it to make it waterproof all over again.
Oh man!
But there's people out there hacking into their Wii U gamepads and cutting off the left and right and saying, "Hey, look, I've got a Switch." Like, yeah, okay.
I don't know if the Switch really is as good as it looks like on the trailer I saw for like gaming on the road. That would be so good for me. I spend a ton of time on the road for work, just hours a week. Just our work sites are hours away from where we are just because I'm in communications, right? So if that really is how it is and I can just set it up and game while I'm I'm getting there. I mean, of course not driving, although I might try. I would be really into
set
that.
Sticks on each side of the steering wheel.
Yeah, exactly. I'd be really into that. Man. So I'm looking forward to it, but again, I won't jump on it on release for sure.
I will probably try and find a way of getting it. I haven't got a means of getting it at this stage. That's the problem when you got mortgages. But if I had a means of getting one, yes, I definitely would be signing up because to get Zelda alone just for that game, that looks awesome, and to be able to play that on the go, I have a 1.5 hour commute each way for my work. That would be awesome to be able to chill out and block out the morons on the train with playing that.
And all those random Twitter messages those damn Carbon Knights guys sent you. But actually, one more thing. Another reason I don't really have a motivation to get it, other than there is some cool, like that Zelda game looks pretty cool. I'm not big on cell shading. I never have been. But it still looks awesome. For the channel, like that's kind of, if I'm getting stuff, it's either to resell or it's for the channel. Generally, like if I happen to get something with something I'm reselling to put in my collection, I do that. Time for shout outs. The best part of the show, in my opinion. Although tonight has been fantastic with Brian being here, I gotta say. This is the most fun we had yet, and we're way over time.
I'm so sorry for that, but I do love talking
things all night.
No, but I do love talking about those days, yeah.
First on the shout outs.
Alright, cool. I'm going to shout out Juicy Monkey. Juicy Monkey Gaming. And he does a lot of first-person shooter stuff, which you guys know I like. And he's doing a lot of Destiny just came out with their newest expansion pack for Xbox One, so he's doing some of that, and he seems he's good. Like, he's really good at the first-person shooters, so it's enjoyable to watch. I think there's some like music in there too, and it's good. I like it a lot. And I think he has 17 subscribers, so you know.
Wow. Oh, he's huge. Come on, Knights, get on it. If you like those first-person shooters, go see Juicy Monkey Gaming. All right, go ahead, Beast.
Sure. My shout-out is channel Z-Star, or Z-Star.
Because they're Canadian.
I still say Z somehow. I don't know. Anyways.
Well, you're pretty close to the border down there.
I guess so, yeah. But that's how they say it on their channel, Z-Star. But see, there's a good mix of first-person shooter, of RTS, and even a Hearthstone and another game called Armella, which is a lot like it. And it's the model of the channel is intellectual gaming, and they have quite a few lists of while they're playing, they'll talk, you know, just like kind of with, you know, what we do in the podcast. Like, hey, do you think that the gaming industry is headed for another mini crash? They talk about things like that, you know. You know, and different loadouts, or like, hey, here's problems with competitive in Overwatch, which they do a lot of things like that, which is good for stimulating conversation and thought in the gaming community, which is always welcome in my view. So I mean, yeah, Z-Star had 54 subscribers, 55 I got on my personal channel, so they're at 55 now, and hopefully they continue to grow with Overwatch and Civilization 6 and some Batman, all kinds of stuff on there.
Cool. Mm-hmm. So, oh, also, I forgot to mention, if you want to find these channels, they will all be in the description below when we're done here. And my choice, because we'll let Brian go last because he's our guest, my choice is actually kind of a buddy of mine on Twitter, buddy of ours, I guess, but I'm the one who runs the Twitter, so it's going to be Mumbles. I love me some Mumbles. He does all kinds of videos. He's got gaming videos, and then he'll do for gaming stuff and for non-gaming stuff. I actually, one of my favorite reviews of his is for a hedge trimmer, and I mean, you guys know how much I love gardening, so of course you I did. Watched it. And, yeah, we had a good little conversation in the comments about the time I cut the cord on my hedge trimmer trying to trim the hedges. So that's Mumbles, and actually we've also been talking to Mumbles a little bit, and we're gonna do a little league with him at some point.
Yes sir.
So that'll be fun. I can't wait. And Brian, who is your shout out?
Yeah, so this is a little bit of a different take on gaming. I like to try and get the Aussie gamers, the YouTubers, I should say, out there. We don't get as much exposure as the US, Canadian, and the English sites, but this guy is a Nintendo fanboy, and he's a teacher. So his channel is called Mr. A Game. That's Mr. A hyphen Game. He does videos every Wednesdays and Saturdays, and as he always says, you better bring your A game. And he's currently, yeah, it's really interesting to watch a teacher doing these kind of videos, because you know we're a bit of potty mouth, Mr. Swearbear over there being quiet. I hear you. And but this guy has to, you know, he has to watch his P's and Q's, because he's got his probably his classroom watching him. So I just find that fascinating that he's currently going through Paper Mario Color Splash, which is an awesome looking game, I must admit, for a Wii U. He's playing that currently at the moment, and he's up to 522 subscribers. I'd like to see that get pushed up. I think he deserves it.
Yeah, I'll definitely check him out. That sounds cool. But anyway, that is going to do it for tonight, Knights. I like it. Anyway, sorry. My brain, it's not working. If you want to ask a question for the podcast next month, you can do so by hitting us up in the comments of any of our videos on Reddit, on our Facebook page, or on Twitter, or you can email us at thecarbonknights@gmail.com as well. You get a little mini shout-out out of it. We say your name out and we'll put it in the comments. And if you want to enjoy any of the shout outs that we've mentioned, they're also in the there will also be a link in the comments. Oh boy, this is getting rough. And if you want to go see more of Brian at Since Spacies. We will also link him in the comments below. I want to thank Brian for being here.
It's been a pleasure.
Some subs out of this, and honestly, I hope we get a few too. That'd be nice. We love you. We're Confederate brothers. Yeah, no, Commonwealth brothers.
Commonwealth brothers. Yes, the Commonwealth. Not Fallout 4 Commonwealth, though.
No. You know, still. See you next time, Knights. Keep those shields up.